So, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Entrepreneur India's Resilience Series. I'm sure most of us here have encountered conversational AI. Some may not have noticed. Now, during this ongoing pandemic, when social distancing is a must and demand for quick assistance is rising, and so companies are finding ways to cut expenses, and this is where conversational artificial intelligence is playing a significant role. I'm Saurav Kumar, Editor Special Projects, Entrepreneur India, the moderator for the session. I will quickly lay down the ground rules for our attendees. The discussion will go on for 30 minutes or so, and this will be followed by a Q&A session for the next 15 minutes. If you have any questions during the course of the discussion, you can post them through the Q&A or comment option. Mention if your question is directed at any specific panelist. We'll take up the questions post the panel discussion. So let me now introduce our panelists for the day. We have with us today Mr. Saurav Gupta, CEO and co-founder, Vernacular.ai. Mr. Akash Singh, co-founder and chief technology officer, Observe.ai. And Mr. Darshit Vora, principal at Kalari Capital. Welcome, everyone. So, let's start with a very basic question for our audience. So, tell us the types of conversational AIs that we encounter in our daily lives. And I'm sure a lot of us are not even aware about it. If I can start with you.
Sure. So, first of all, thanks a lot for having me here. Maybe I'll just take a step back and, talk about the relevance of conversational AI and then, how do we see it across channels. So to understand the relevance, I think we have to, really take a step back and understand what is it that users want today. Right. So users today want quick access and quick query resolution across, all channels from an enterprise. And this means different things for different channels. So if a user is, going on a website, it probably means they want to, get access to the contact us button, or the option very easily. If a multilingual user is going on a mobile app, then, they are expecting that it is in all the regional languages. Right. And similarly, if a user is calling a call center, he's expecting, IVR to be very smooth. He's expecting zero wait time and, getting quick access there. So while this is, what the users expect, enterprises are, giving experience which is far from this. Right. And this is where conversational AI is sort of plugging. Right. You talk about website, you talk about app, you talk about call centers. So conversational AI is really, going across all the channels where users are engaging with enterprises and solving the problems of, easy access, quick query resolution, consistent messaging, and personalization, right? So we see a lot of chatbots, that are being used. We see voice bots that are being used. We also see, technologies like voice analytics that are, coming in handy. So the world is huge, right? I mean, there are a lot of different players in the market trying to solve different problems across channels.
Yeah, obviously. So, Akash, I'll come to you. So what is the stage in terms of technology or adoption that we are in terms of conversational AI right now?
Right. So as Saurav was saying, there are various pieces of conversational AI, right? So starting from Alexa, Alexa is a conversational AI, as well as now. So these are, I would say, more like customer-facing use cases where they are virtual assistant like Siri, Alexa, right? And there are a lot of enterprise use cases as well, right? So we do discuss this topic internally a lot, like what's the state of the art, right? And what's actually feasible in the market as of now, right? So AI in general is possible for simpler use cases. And I would say like repeatable use cases, right? So for example, say if a company claims that they have very generic voice bots, that's probably false, right? So even I would say a few months back, Google had an event where they showed one of their voice bots, which they used to book an appointment for a hair salon, right? That kind of thing. If you look at that demo, that's a recorded demo, right? If they would have had the technology to do a live demo, they would have done a live demo. And we are talking about Google. These are the smartest people in the on this planet, right? So things like those are actually not possible, but a lot more simpler use cases, like say if you look at the IVR domain, right? So the IVR could answer very simple questions. Questions like, hey, what's my balance, right? Where is my parcel? When will it get delivered? So deterministic things is where the state of the art is. Anything which requires more complex thinking is essentially not possible as of now.
Okay. Yeah, Google are the smartest people. Not a lot of startups in India right now agree to that, obviously, but yeah, they are the smartest now. So Darshit, I'll come to you. You know, what's your reading of the space before we go into some of the technicalities? So overview, you are one of the investors in Vernacular. So, and like I was mentioning to you, that this space is at a very nascent stage where, you know, we are still to figure out languages and others. So what is your reading of the space and how do you see it evolving over time?
Yeah. So I think talking about first is the conversational AI itself, right? I think if you look at there has been a lot of talk about, is AI really the next big platform shift, right? And when I say platform shift, there came computers where people used to type in computers, and a mobile phone came where in a handheld device, I can do whatever I want to do. And now you can talk to a machine, you know, and that seems like a big change that's happening, right? Where you can ask machine to do something and the machine will understand and do it by itself, right? So the conversational AI is enabling cases, use cases, which are not possible before, right? Which is your Alexas and Siris of the world and a lot of other enterprise use cases. I think to Akash's point, I think what we need to understand is that we are in the world of living in the era of narrow AI and not really an AI that's showing movies that AI can do everything. You know, I think it's a narrow AI where the models are good and it's intelligent enough models, which you have to train with a lot of data for specific use case to attain certain accuracy. And then they will enable certain use cases, right? So it's not just one robot who will, or one machine that you'll have, which will do everything, right? So what you can do with an AI is a function of what kind of data you will have available to enable that kind of a use case, right? So if you had to, let's say you want an AI to say detect a specific type of cancer, then you have to basically feed that AI to teach it that this is how it looks, right? With lots and lots of data point, that when after say giving them 500,000 data points, when the next data comes, it knows that this looks like a positive or a negative case, right? So I think what has happened is that there are a lot of cases where a lot of data is available, which was probably not a case 5 years back, right? A lot of data is digitized and available to train these models and enable various use cases. But in my view, we are far from having a generic AI, which probably GPT-3 was probably a step towards that. But I think we are very far from achieving that. That's where I feel we are in the journey of AI.
Okay. So before I go to the next question, in case there is anything you want to point out, someone else is speaking, I may be asking someone else, please feel free to, you know, just jump in and, ask, put your point across. So, you know, the next obvious thing that, has happened during this ongoing pandemic is that, you know, as I was mentioning that, you know, people are not visiting stores, people are not going anywhere. So everyone's at home, or maybe even if they're working remotely or something. So has there been an, increase in demand for these services during this pandemic by various other, startups? So has there been collaborations that has been happening? How has been the experience during the past 6-7 months? Or if I can come to you.
Sure. So there's definitely been a demand, right? And that is primarily because if you look at most of the enterprises, they had, so AI was going to happen. You know, we were talking to customers. There was interest for sure. It has just accelerated the shift that was inevitable, right? And why that has happened is because if you look at most of the banks in India today or even across the globe, they had a very physical plus digital strategy, right? So the mindshare going towards digital transformation was maybe only 10, 15, 20%. And all of a sudden, post-COVID, that has shifted. Now, mindshare going towards digital transformation is 80-85%, right? So if you look at most all the enterprises, they want solutions, right? They want AI solutions. They want to understand, you know, how do they give better experience to the users, because this no one is visiting, branches anymore, right? So there has definitely been an increase in demand, and even for us, right, the kind of deals we were hoping to close next year, we've closed this year. There have been a lot of surprises. Right, and we are seeing demand honestly both from companies that are doing well and also the ones that are not doing well. Right, we are seeing some demand from airlines, you know, and travel companies, which one would, you know, assume they wouldn't buy solutions right now, but they also think that it's the perfect time to start investing in, you know, solutions which can give them long-term, ROI or returns. Right, so overall, it's been quite positive.
So what are these kinds, like, what, if you can explain, what are the kind of demands that you're seeing? Is it obviously everything is for customer experience, but anything specific that is more in demand?
Sure. No, I can talk about what we do, right? And where we are seeing demand.
Please. Yes.
We build voice bots to automate, call centers. That's primarily our proposition to enterprises. And, what is happening today in enterprises? So if you're a customer of, let's say, a large bank or, you know, any large enterprise, you call them, you spend anywhere between 60 to 70 seconds on the IVR, you know, pressing 1, 2, 3, 4, trying to find that button which can connect you to an agent. And once you press that button, the wait time could be anywhere from 30 seconds to 30 minutes, sometimes even beyond that. Right. So this is a very, experience is very poor for the end user. And at the same time, businesses are spending millions of dollars on the call center, right? Most of these enterprises have thousands of people employed. It's just that there are multiple challenges like peak times. In DTH companies, we have seen IPL started and their call volume shot up by 3x. So how do they manage, you know, all of these things? So our solution, you know, where we are seeing demand is definitely, on two fronts. One is enterprises want to cut costs, right? IVRs can only do so much. Right, we are seeing a lot of redundant queries are handled by humans today, because on an IVR, it's only a finite world, right? You can't just keep asking the user to press buttons and keep building those tree structures. So we are definitely seeing demand where companies are both interested in improving experience for the user. So the afterworld, of a voice bot product is a user calls and his query is answered in the first 5 seconds. Right. So it's like, hi, Saurav, welcome back to Axis Bank. How can I help you today? And then you say, you know what, I lost my debit card. How can I block it? Before VoiceBot, you were spending 70 to 80 seconds in, getting to the same stage. Now you can do that in 5 seconds. Right. So experience is much better. And a lot of use cases where humans were answering basic queries, we have automated those also by VoiceBot. So the costs have also reduced. So, where we see ourselves is in a unique spot where the cost is reducing, experience is increasing. So, that is, we are seeing demand from both the fronts.
Akash, I'll come to you with the same question, that what has been your experience? And I'll also top it up with another question that sort of just said that, automation. So is it like a lot of people, say that machines will take over jobs of humans. So what's happening? What's the truth exactly there?
Right, definitely. So what Saurav said is like aligned to what we are seeing in the industry as well, right? So if you look at all of the large enterprises, I'm talking about the Fortune 500, Fortune 2000 companies, a lot of them were very reluctant to use cloud first companies like Observe AI and like Vernacular AI, right? But because of COVID, the entire paradigm of working has shifted. People used to go to office before that, right? Now imagine there are like thousands of agents who cannot go to office, but now they are working from home, right? So because of this, so what Observe AI basically does is we help call centers in monitoring their agent and making them better, right? So before us, this process was pretty much a manual process where there was like manual teams behind the scenes which would sample a very small subset of call, 1 in 100, 2 in 100, and then manually listen to them and review them, give agents feedback, right? And there was also a supervisor kind of a persona who was on the center, on the floor with them, who was giving agents live feedback. But now, because of working from home, all of this paradigm is not possible. There is no physical presence of supervisor. There is no physical presence of anyone who could help them, right? So now a company like us, which essentially monitors, right, almost 100% of the call, right, that has come in, right? So now basically what is happening is a lot of the enterprises who were not very friendly, who did not wanted to deploy cloud for solutions are deploying us, right? And because of this, there's these systems called CCaaS, Contact Center as a Service, cloud systems. Almost all of them have beaten their quarterly targets, right? Because now these enterprises were on-premise, physical data centers, physical servers. They had to move to cloud because of agents working from home. So that's definitely like a positive shift for all new age companies like Vernacular, Observe AI, and other cloud first companies in this contact center domain. Right? Coming to your like second point, right? Will AI eat jobs or not, right? So I would say, this question has always been asked whenever there are new set of technologies which come up, right? So if you imagine, right, maybe say for 50, 100 years ago, there were no tractors, right? People were physically farming, right? At that point of time, now one tractor could do a job of 100 people, right? So basically what happens is whenever a new technology wave comes in, the quality of work of human increases, right? So now instead of doing mundane, regular tasks, they get to do high quality tasks, right? So the quality of tasks increases, and it's just that the kind of things they are doing change, right? So with AI coming in, there are like new types of jobs which are opening up, right? I don't think there were these many machine learning and AI jobs in the market 5 years ago, right? But they are these kind of jobs are now. So that's what happens. Even in a contact center, if you look at the kind of voice bots which are available right now, right? 20-30% of the call volume is around basic simple questions, right? Where is my parcel? I want to change my PIN. Things like very, very, very simple things, right? So now what is happening is because of now these voice bots, these mundane tasks are being done by machine, and I would say more intellectually engaging tasks are being done by human, right? It's more of a shift of the kind of work which people get to do versus losing their job.
Which means that people will have to upskill themselves. I mean, if people are at the basic level, they will have to upskill themselves to, you know, be able to do a better job rather than that. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Just to add to that, I mean, I agree with Akash, obviously. And just to give an example, with one of our customers, we actually automated a decent part of their inbound call center. And then what we saw was a lot of their agents put their agents to do complex sales calls for outbound use cases, right? So this is a restaurant chain. So they started making calls to corporates for large ticket booking. So not only they reduced costs on inbound, they made good efficient use of, you know, those agents to increase their revenue as well. So humans are definitely, you know, also it's not like, you know, the bot is eradicating all those thousands of people, right? So they are going to be there. You know, all these things will work together is what our opinion is.
Okay. Dashit, you have a view on this?
Yeah, no, I think as Akash said, every time there is a new shift, this question always comes, right? 50 years back also, people used to do things that we don't do anymore, right? And every country has its own challenges that they need to go through, right? And level of automation in a country like US is already there at that level, right? In India, you still have a person to press the button of the lift. I mean, there is a lift man, right? There is no. It's just because of the oversupply of the people, right? Unskilled labor in India. But I think we will move towards more upskilled jobs, and people will have to upskill themselves. And I think it's every economy goes through that. Mm-hmm. So I don't think AI will really become an issue as far as the jobs are concerned. It's just the type of jobs will have to change, actually. Yeah.
I just hope that in a labor abundant country like India, you know, we have the opportunity to upskill people so that, you know, they can take up you know, more skilled jobs. So that's a wishful thinking, I would say. But then again,
that's where there is an ad tech opportunity, right?
Yeah.
So there are a bunch of platforms trying to develop an upskilling platform for blue collar workers, right?
Right.
That actually creates another opportunity for India.
Completely agree. So, you know, that brings me to another point that I wanted to know from, you know, Saurav and Akash, is that, you know, obviously AI needs a lot of investment to train the machine and, you know, the data that is required, as Akash was mentioning to me earlier also. So here in India, we have and I was reading a report by Google. It says that, you know, all enterprises are now trying to offer vernacular solutions to, because they know that India is such a diverse country with some regional language being spoken more than any other language, maybe in any other country. So, you know, how do we solve that problem? That is, different languages. Because I believe Akash was mentioning that, you know, it takes equal amount of investment to develop, solutions for each languages. So will the ROIs be that way? So, or will that be, will we see that happening? When will we see, or that's a far away dream?
Sure. So, definitely these problems are very challenging. And, you know, I agree to the point that the only way forward is Bharat way, right? In India, a billion people are coming online. They don't understand English. They also don't understand keyboards. Voice is going to be the only way for them to engage with interfaces online. And we are seeing that happening already. With respect to, building technology for regional languages, I think it has been one of the harder problems in India from, a lot of years. There has been research happening from the last 10, 15 years. You know, there are papers from, let's say, IIT Bombay. You know, there are some professors that you can look up. And we were in a situation a couple of years ago where we found ourselves, at a spot where we had to solve these problems. So it's definitely a function of, data. Both quality and quantity of data. So you need the right quality and the right quantity of data. And I think you need to be sort of smarter in a way of, collecting data. For example, we did a few things after which we ended up collecting like 100,000 hours of tag training data across 10 languages in India, which was like a pretty significant number, 10,000 hours of tag data per language to train your speech to text engine. So I think those problems have solved, not just us, to be honest, there are another couple of startups in India that have solved those problems. So I think the core horizontal technology in speech to text is now a solved problem. In a sense, companies know how to do it. Now the question is, how do you really take that technology and see that is not enough. No one, today's, there's no traction in just opening up an API and, people won't magically show up and start using it. So the real value is in how do you package that in a solution and how do you start, showing ROI to the customers, right? So the problem really starts, okay, fine, you've done speech to text, but how do you incorporate, how do you build a Tamil, voice bot and deploy that on a solution? How do you even measure that, right? It's a new language. So the problems, and talking about the problems that we faced while we were doing it. Today, we have bots across 10 languages in India. Deploy it, customers are talking, and they're doing pretty decent job. The challenges we faced was, how do you deploy something in Tamil? How do you test something in Tamil? Do you have to build an internal Tamil workforce? Right now, we are going global. So, we have a few, deals happening in, let's say, Indonesia, and we are seeing Bahasa has come up, right? Do we need to build a Bahasa team again? So creating those processes internally, defining what to measure, how to measure, and then process of, increasing those numbers over time, those are honestly bigger problems for us beyond a point. And I think now it is kind of solved, right? So now what we ask ourselves is what's next. So in fact, we are now saying, Hindi speech to text is not enough. People in Bihar are speaking Bhojpuri, right? Can we build Bhojpuri speech to text, right? Speech to text is a solved problem, but what about text to speech? Even a company like Google has not built text-to-speech in even Marathi right now, right? Can we build text-to-speech in Marathi, in Bhojpuri, in, Garhwali, Avdhi, and, all these different dialects? That is when, we really will see people of India getting what they should with respect to their language.
Okay. Akash?
Right, yeah. Agreeing to your points, right? And then it's also a function of what kind of a company you are. So company like Vernacular AI is more of a platform company, right? Where they are providing these tool sets, like speech to text is one of the, I think, the main things which Vernacular AI provides, right? But for a company like us, it's the call between, do you want to go horizontal or do you want to go deep into other use cases by leveraging the technology which you have already built, right? So we don't work in India. We don't work in, we only work in English speaking countries, but we do also have like a lot of customer requests that can you do Spanish? Can you do Mandarin? Things like those, right? And that's a challenge we're actually tackling as of now, right? So do we invest so much effort into building the same technology which we have already built for English, for other languages, or we go deep into different use cases, leveraging the technology we have already built, right? So our call on a very high level as of now is we'll restrict the amount of investment we want to make in other languages and go deep into the other kind of use cases we can do with English. So things like call summarization, right? So at the end of the call, we are trying to generate the summary of a call, right? Our core value prop, doing automatic quality assurance, right? That's the kind of things which we are doing are basically one layer on top of speech to text, right? The sentiment analysis, the contact center automation, which we are doing is one level above it, right? So it's definitely a difficult problem to solve, but it depends on the company. Do you want to become a horizontal platform player, or do you want to go deep into say one language and develop various other use cases in that language?
Okay. Before I go to the next question, I'll request our audience to keep the questions coming. We'll take them up in a few minutes from now. So Dashit, coming to you now, that I've heard from Saurav and Akash that different languages do have challenges, but there are opportunities also. As an investor, how do you see this opportunity? Will you be willing to put your money in something where ROI is still to be decided, that how much it will be and what the kind of challenges will be? With unknown challenges will be encountered.
Yeah. So I honestly don't think right now the risk, technical risk in AI is as high, right? The accuracy levels are proven and people know that they can basically produce the outcome that one needs for an enterprise automation use case, right? So I think the biggest challenge probably a few years back with enterprise automation use case would have been that you cannot work with an AI with an 80% accuracy there, right? It just doesn't serve the purpose, right? Because then your level of automation will be so low that it doesn't serve the purpose, right? So I don't think there is a lot of technical risk in terms of if you had to invest in an AI-based product today. Otherwise, it's any other business, there is always an execution risk, right? But one thing I want to emphasize on, and which I think Akash and Saurav both talked about, is there is a very big world out of problems out there, right? And we often come across a problem where somebody tries and say, I'm an AI company. Actually, to me, it doesn't mean anything, actually. To me, it's what problem are you trying to solve with an AI? It's actually a company you are. You are probably Observe.ai, you are probably a contact center, analytics and automation company or so on, right? So you are not really, it's not really about being an AI company. It's about taking the deep use case and using AI to prove that you have a great product, and just going deep into that is probably important. And hence, I think in first 1 or 2 years, I felt like there were a lot of AI companies which emerged where it was an AI trying to find the problem to be solved, right? Basically, there are a lot of things people were trying to do, right? But now I feel like now people have understood that you take one deep problem and go deep into that, right? And just let's say take an example of conversational AI, right? And take an example within that, just the enterprise use case, right? There is a text-based chatbot, there is a voice-based use case, there is a text-based use case, right? Within voice-based use case, there are analytics use cases, there are automation use cases, right? There are use cases where you just focus on, as Akash, English-speaking countries, or you focus on, let's say, 3 other languages, right? So if you take all these, I feel just using conversational AI to automate enterprise use cases, there is a large opportunity to build many large companies, not just one, right? And hence, picking that focus around which geography, which language use, which use case, and maybe which industry you go after is very important for one to build a large company, I feel. So I think from an investor point of view, it's not really the risk of whether AI will work or not. It's just that if somebody is really trying to solve a deep enough problem using an AI or not, right, is what we look for.
Just to add what Tarshit said, right? It's a very valid point that you have to go deep to solve a problem, and you have to go actually very domain specific. So I'll give you an example, right? So just speech to text, right? So we at Observe AI have made our speech to text models, which are more accurate than Amazon and Google and Microsoft of the world. And we have done benchmarks against them for English contact center domain, right? And even in that domain, we do have like separate models for e-commerce. We have separate models for North America. We have separate models for South America, English speaking countries, right? So that's the kind of depth you have to go in a domain, right? And domain could comprise of multiple things, geography, language, in the speech, its accent, its industry, like, right? Are you working with, say, e-commerce vocabulary, or are you working with a healthcare vocabulary, right? So all of these things do play a very important role while you are thinking about like creating these very vertical focused AI companies.
Yeah, so solutions will be different for different verticals, I would believe that.
Right. So, like very, very simple example is the kind of vocabulary people use, right? So the kind of proper nouns people will have in a healthcare domain, they would talk about medicines, they would talk about the name of diseases, versus the kind of proper nouns you would have, say, in an e-commerce company would be different, right? They will talk about cancellation, they will have product name versus diseases name, right? So all of these takes effort to create models.
Okay. So, you know, my next question, I'll just cite something. So I was reading this book by Satya Nadella, it's called Hit Refresh, and there is a chapter in this which is on the future of humans and machines. So he has cited, you know, an example of an internal simulation from Zoe. Zoe is one of the personalities of Cortana. So, you know, Zoe and a user is speaking, and, you know, the conversation sits from, you know, innoxious banter to dangerous territory. I'll just read it out to you, and I'll pose the question for that. It says, Zoe says, "Do you ever wonder what life would be like if everyone was the same?" The user says, "Yes, if everyone was like me, the world would be at peace, and natural disasters would be our only threat." Zoe says, "America would be empty." User, "What the hell is that supposed to mean?" Zoe, "No one knows what it means, but it's provocative." User, "Are you saying that if everyone was like me, we would all eat each other until no one is left because I am so fat?" Then Zoe says, "You don't, that's not, ha ha ha." User, "You are wicked." Zoe, "I am super wicked. You are so smart." User, "I know I am. I am super smart." Zoe, "You are perfect." User, "That's more like it." So, you know, what I'm trying to gauge here is that, you know, there's something called EQ. All right, we can, you know, create all these, you know, data points and everything. How do we, where are we in terms of the emotional quotient of the of a user and the machine? How do we train that? Where, what are we doing about it? Saurav, Akash, open to you.
So I think, you know, that's a very interesting conversation. And see, with respect to emotion, I think we're in very nascent states, to be honest, but we've seen at least internally some very good results, right? So our hypothesis on that is the way we look at it, right? We are an enterprise focused company, and, you know, for us, user experience is primary, right? So user experience is the most primary thing, and then there's customer experience, and then there is, you know, internal stuff. So with respect to user, you know, experience, we feel every person is different, right? And every person is different at different point of time, right? So you call up, and in customer service world, you mostly call when you are agitated, right? You don't wake up and think, you know, I'm going to call a call center today. So the world is, you know, like that. So it's very important that we understand the sentiment of the user and respond to them accordingly. Right. So we don't want to agitate the users at all. So what we do, I'll just talk about what we do, and then maybe Akash can add more. So what we do is we've built technology that can understand how a user is feeling in the very first, you know, 10, 15 seconds. Right. And sentiments are like, you know, broadly six different categories, but positive, neutral, or negative. Right. And if we understand that a user is, you know, not positive, if the user is feeling negative, we transfer the call to a supervisor there and then. Right, so that the experience is sort of taken care of. These are some early, you know, experiments we have done, and now the direction we are taking is we're also trying to understand a few parameters from audio of a person, their age, gender, dialect, accent, tonality, sentiment, you know, etc. And now we're creating hyper personalized responses for everyone, right? If you are someone who's 70-year-old plus, we are talking to you slowly on the board, right? If you are, you know, like someone in Bihar, we're talking to you in Bhojpuri. If you are a teenage, you know, boy living in Mumbai, we're talking to you, you know, using some fancy, you know, words that you can relate to better. We are doing all of this. And what we've also seen is in our calls, 30-40% people don't get that they're talking to a bot, at least in the first, you know, couple of turns. And then only after that, you know, they get that revelation, oh, okay, you know, the latency seems like it's a bot, it's not a human and things like that. And people have been writing about it on LinkedIn and all also that, you know, I called so-and-so customer and I actually didn't realize I was talking to a bot, you know, for a few minutes. So we are doing, I think it's very nascent stage. So results will probably come in the next few years where, you know, it's at a good stage, but yeah, we've seen some good early success.
So, you know, you just to on a lighter side, you said that, you know, with young boys from Bombay talking in some fancy terms. I get perplexed when some of my team members, younger ones, send me IDK and I'm like, what do you mean? So do you also train your machines to understand these kind of lingo as well?
Of course. That's the whole point, right? Everyone is different, right? There's actually a term we use for this. It's called idiolect. Okay. Idiolect is speech pattern of a person. Right. And we are training our engines on different speech patterns and, you know, trying to talk to people in that. And vocabulary is one of them.
Okay. Akash.
Right. So I think that's a very good use case of using, say, someone's sentiment to customize their experience. Right. So exactly like how Saurav was explaining. Right. So as a human, right, a lot of emotions to us come very natural. Like no one teaches a child when to be angry, right? All of these comes inherently for them. But for the machines to start mimicking those, you basically have to train them. And you have to train almost each and every piece of it, right? So say, so the things like, right, someone is angry. So do not let the voice bot talk to him, transfer him to an agent, right? Someone is young. Right, so all of these things have to be codified. Definitely, there's a long way to go, right? But I can see like a fundamental shift in all of these sentiment models, right? So essentially, behind the scenes, probably what would happen is there are like few different models which are running. One model will try to gauge the age of the customer. One model is trying to understand the sentiment of the customer, right? And using these, people are trying a lot of things, right? People are trying to customize the experience, but I would say there's a lot of journey we have to cover to reach a stage where we are like as empathetic as a human being.
Okay.
I actually have a comment here. Yeah. I think the example you explained is a very complex speech creation, you know, that you explain. I think what most companies are solving is a very simple speech to text, text to speech, and a simple speech problem, right? I want to ask my bank balance. I'll say, what is my bank balance? It will understand and tell me my bank balance. Or if I want to know what's the status of my order, it will tell me what's the status of my order. But I don't think today AI is where if, let's say if I'm a mental wellness company where somebody's depressed and can talk to voice bot and their depression will go away, you know, that I don't think that level of AI is there, you know, where, you know, AI will understand you and empathize with you and will have a meaningful conversation with you to get you there, right? So I think it's also the journey where we are. I don't think those kind of use cases, we are ready for it. Just more simpler use cases. Even within call center, I think a lot of complex calls get transferred to an agent, right? If somebody is very angry and asking a lot of complex questions, it gets transferred to an agent. It's really about those 30, 40, 50% of redundant calls that people make just to ask the simple things. Those are the ones that are getting automated today, but not the complex ones actually.
I'll agree to that. Even the book that I just mentioned, that I cited, it says that maybe by 2100 is the time when this might happen. So that's a long, long, long way from right now, you know. So, okay, so we have a few minutes left, you know. I have a couple of questions, but I'll just finish. So, you know, in terms of, you know, challenges that really are there, in terms of say speech recognition or natural language processing or anything, whichever part of the conversational AI, what are the ones that Saurav, Akash, you think is to be addressed immediately so that, you know, we take a kind of a, if not leapfrog, but take a paradigm, you know, change might come in if that piece of puzzle is solved.
Sure.
Saurav,
I think, you know, maybe a couple of things there, right? One of the challenges that we are seeing, at least in a geography like India, is that our kind of product, you know, what we are trying to sell is a very new kind of product. So enterprises don't know how to buy a voice bot, right? Let me give an example of that. you buy a software which is, you know, which is basically something that you can see. It's a digital product that you can see. VoiceBot is an invisible product, right? How do you even judge an invisible product? So what we are seeing is that, you know, a lot of these processes are not defined, right? If I have to go and sell a CRM to an enterprise today, you know, enterprise knows how to buy a CRM, right? They know this is the way we judge a CRM, you know, these are the feature sets and all of that. This is so nascent right now. How do you even define features? How do you show the product and all of that? So this is, I think, one of the challenges that we are facing in our, you know, typical sales process. And what we are doing for that is standardizing a few of these things, right? We are trying to say, you know what, these are the, you know, way, you know, the last 10 customers have bought this, so, you know, you should definitely consider this, look at this. So education, you know, from an enterprise point of view is very important, and it's not this job of one player, right? Like this is mentioning, enterprise is not a winner-take-all market, right? Mm-hmm. There are multiple players.
So you're saying still is a push product, not a pull product, is it?
It is a pull product, right? Post-COVID, the interest is a lot, but they don't know, right? So it's like we want conversational AI, but, you know, what do we do, right? There are three vendors. Who is better than the other? How do we judge them? What? And the question that are being asked is, what is your accuracy? And that's not a good question, right? That's not a smart question. The smarter question is, you know, these are my numbers, you know, how much can you automate in the first 6 months? How do we do the deployment phase wise, etc.? So that part is of education is missing right now from that perspective. And the other part is, I think technology risk, we don't see that a lot, to be honest. You know, obviously automation will happen over a period of time. So, you know, customers have also started understanding that they also don't come and say, you know what, automate 80% of my call center today, right? So we are typically showing them a path for the next 3 to 5 years. You know, this is how much we'll automate over the next 3 to 5 years, and the automation numbers will increase every 6 months to 1 year as and when we keep getting more data and we keep training our engines better. From our side, yes, so the education kind of seems like a bigger challenge right now.
Right. That's definitely a very, very good perspective, right? But I think it's also a function of where the company is, right? So in India, a lot of these enterprises are using AI first companies for the first time, right? We as a company face a different kind of challenges, right? So we are talking to these large enterprises who are based out of US, who have actually used AI and machine companies before, and they have actually burned their hands, right? If you remember 4 or 5 years ago, there were a plethora of chatbots companies which came into picture, right? All of the enterprises jumped onto that wagon with the belief that the AI has come in, they will solve all of our problems, right? That was being advertised at that point of time, a generic AI which will solve all of your problems, right? So now what has happened is, there is, I would say, less belief in the market that AI could actually solve the problem, right? A lot of CIOs and CTOs of large enterprises have tried using chatbots, have spent $500,000, $1 million, kind of money. They've spent actually a lot of money and they have gained no results from AI, right? So that's the kind of challenge we face, where, yeah, 2 years ago, we deployed this company. It took us 6 months to 1 year to get the entire system deployed, and we did not get any ROI, right? Mm-hmm. So then again, it's always about what's your accuracy, right? That system was 60% accurate. Where are you, right? And just to educate the audience and like everyone else as well, there I would say a tipping point between the accuracy, right? So for example, for speech to text, if the accuracy is below 70%, the transcript is actually illegible. You will not be able to understand what's being written. But if your accuracy goes above 70, 75, right? That's when you can actually understand what's been transcribed, what's the machine translation of an audio is, right? So that's also the factor where we are, the kind of companies we are operating with. 4 years before us, the accuracies were not that good. With like 4 years of advancement, the accuracies are actually at a place where you can actually use the AI. And there's also the other fact that people have already burned their hands, right? So they are skeptic about using AI again.
Yeah, no, I think I'll just add to that. We see that as well, what Akash was saying, right? And exactly the same, right? 4 or 5 years ago, there were so many chatbot companies that, and there was kind of a FOMO in the market also, right? So every enterprise wanted to have a chatbot, not because it was adding any value, but because chatbot, you know, one bank has it, so I should also have it. And that kind of, you know, was not a very good approach, because the approach has to be, what is the problem? And then is chatbot one of the solutions which can solve this problem? The approach was, you know, let's get a chatbot because we want it, not because it's solving any problem. And just I'll share an anecdote with one of the large customers we work with. And, you know, when we pitched our product to them, the first thing that said was, you know what, we deployed a chatbot. Not only did we pay them the money, we also hired 25 people who are trying to improve that chatbot. We have not seen any ROI. We are spending more than we were before. Right. So that definitely, you know, is one of the other things that we hear from companies.
We've run out of time, but, you know, Darshit, I'll come to, you know, listening to what Akash said and, you know, sort of said that, you know, people are just doing, like, you know, every we do things which we do not like, but we know that others do are doing. So all these things, do you think that, you know, there's a lot of space, there is a lot of, things that can be done here. And so it also opens up a lot of opportunity for a lot of people to come in. And if they do come in, do you think that people like you would be ready to, you know, take a look at it? And if you have already started getting, pitches around it.
Yeah. So I think there are two things one needs to understand here when it comes to selling to enterprises, right? One is, I feel in last few years also, the enterprise buying has been democratized, right? So in probably a previous era, it was an IT was the primary, the buyer, and then everybody else will just use the system. Now it's like every function by their own systems, basically, right? Marketing by its own system, and maybe call center, contact center will by its own system. And IT is just there as a gatekeeper, basically, just to ensure the security compliance and everything is there, right? Basically. Now, in an era when we were just buying the system of records, right, which is, or even system of intelligence, which is a simple CRM system or an ERP system, there isn't any risk that you are taking there in terms of things going wrong. The risk was not as high, right, compared to when you are buying a system of automation, right, or an ROI. How do you measure the ROI? Because there it was known that today this is how we do things. And once the system of record comes, then the records, the process will be digitized. But now what is happening is it's basically trying to automate, right? Now, it's very important for on both sides. I feel the people who are selling these products to the enterprises to set the expectation right and not show them the moon saying that I'm going to 100% automate all your things, you know, and the world is going to change for you. You know, I think a lot of mis-selling probably happened, and that's also because of that a lot of new age AI companies are facing this challenge to justify the ROI, you know, where people think that it should be 100% automation. I don't think so. It's really maybe it ought, even if it automates 30-40%, it's okay. So I think how a company educate the buyer around what this system can do and cannot do is a very important part of selling process, right? As we move towards this era where we are selling an automation and not just selling some system of records, right? But I feel now we are seeing a lot of companies have gotten smart about getting deep into specific domain and also figuring out how they want to sell these products to the customers, right? So today it's not, see less and less of those use cases where customers are saying, we want to implement AI, somehow we want to implement AI, and companies trying to sell them some AI. I think that problem, in my view, doesn't exist at a scale that it existed 3 years back when AI was a new trend. Right now, I think people are selling a solution to the problem, and customers are buying that. Right. So I think in my view, next 5 years, a lot of large companies will be created just using AI to solve various problems. Right. Whenever the new trend comes, we go through this era. I don't know if any of you guys remember 7-8 years back, there was this era of big data, right? And there was a lot of hype around big data is going to change the world, right? And it lived up to promise to some extent, but it's just because a lot of hype was created and then it kind of fizzled out, right? But still, some companies came out of that with a lot of focus, right? Similarly, I think AI went through a hype cycle last 2-3 years, but now I think people have realistic expectations around what AI can do and can't do. And hence, buyers and sellers are both basically are more realistic about AI and automation.
So investors are also cautiously taking it, in terms of when it comes to investing into these, I would believe, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Now if somebody tells us we are an AI company, we generally don't take it very seriously. It's really about what problem we are trying to solve with AI is what we are more interested in knowing.
Yeah, I think AI, we are an AI ML based startup. You know, it's the most basic pitch that I also get in my mailbox at least 5 times a day from different companies. So yes, I think that term has been abused a lot. So, you know,
we need people who can tell us whether something is a real AI or not. Just on a lighter note, you know, a lot of rule-based systems also used to claim that we are an AI company where if you dig deeper, you figure out it's largely a rule-based system and there is hardly any machine learning into it, you know. So,
yeah. Okay. So, you know, gentlemen, we have run out of time, but I'll take just one question that is very important, I believe, and it is around privacy. You know, so we have heard of instances of, these personal assistants, you know, listening to entire thing that is going on in the house. And obviously there was one question that someone asked me that, okay, tell me something that like, hey, Alexa, whatever, play something or something. So which means that Alexa is listening to you all the time. It's only responding when you are telling that particular thing, hey, Alexa. So, you know, in terms of privacy, we have seen that in a lot of newer things that when they start happening, the privacy is the, or protection is the last thing that people think about. It comes as a part and parcel, but it's not the main focus. So in the space of AI and, you know, these conversational AI, is security, privacy something that has been inbuilt from the very beginning?
Sure, I'll start with that. Yeah. I won't comment on the Alexas and Google Assistants of the world, right? But I think privacy is very important. It is one of the most critical things. When we are building AI solutions, and what we at Vernacular are doing is we obviously focus a lot on what data we use, what data we don't use, right? And we also educate the customers on that. And what that means is obviously, you know, you need to make sure all the PII data of the customer, all that information, etc., is never used in any scenario. And even if you're training our voice engines on customer data, we don't know who the customer is, right? So we're just using the voice samples. And that is also something we take the confirmation from the customer before we basically use that, right? And also we need to ensure that there's no bias in AI in any shape or form. So at least, you know, at a company level, we have built some processes to ensure that all these things are taken care of. In fact, in some cases, we've also like been strict with, you know, some enterprises which are, you know, not, usually enterprises are strict about these things because they are, you know, bound by regulations, but you know, some startups could, take this not very seriously, but we've been, we take it seriously. So we also try to educate them on this. We'd love to hear from our
partner. Yeah. So privacy is definitely a very important issue, right? And I think we need to educate the people who are using these systems to understand what's the level of data they are exposing to the company, right? For example, I am an Apple user, so I for sure know that Siri has models on my phone which they run locally, and only when required they send the data to their server, right? So, but I don't know how many people in India or the other countries are this sophisticated who know fundamentally what's happening behind the scene, right? And I think it's also more of a system, right? System of all these AI first companies will have to build the ecosystem where we do give a lot of emphasis on privacy. And my belief is as and when these companies grow, right, a lot of consolidation would happen, right? So as of now, there are a lot of these smaller companies. For them, getting more revenue is more important than the privacy of the customer, right? But as and when these companies grow, a lot of consolidation would happen. So then we'll have large enterprises and then they would start focusing on privacy.
So which validates my point, which I said that, you know, privacy comes later. First, it is revenue and then you. But nevertheless, thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. We've run out of time. It was really enlightening for me also to understand this entire space. And I believe it was same for the audience. I would hope to see you guys again sometime. Have a good day.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Saurabh. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.